Sugadam Kevalam Yanamurtim Dvandvatitam Ganganasadrisham Tattva Syadilaksham Ekam Nityam Vimalamachalam Sarvadi Sakshibhutam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadgurum Tam Namami Narayanam Padmabhavam Vashishtam Shaktim Chitat Putra Parasarancha Vyasam Sukham Gaudapadam Mahantam Govinda Yogin Ramatasya Shishyam Sri Shankaracharya Matasya Padma Padam Chastamalakancha Shishyam Tam Totikam Bhartika Karmanyan Asmad Gurum Shantatamanatoshmihi Vishwam darpana drishyamani nagari tulyam nijan targatam pasyanatmani mayaya by vuribod bhutam yata nidrayam yasakshat kurute prabodha samaye swatmanameva dvayam tasmai shri gurumurtaye namaitam shri dakshinamurtaye Namaha. Yeah, so just explain the rules. For satsang, for Vedanta teaching. This isn't a satsang like the normal Neo-Advaita satsangs that you are probably familiar with. We don't get you up front in the hot seat and get you to tell your story and make you feel good. Vedanta is a communication between your mind, your heart and your mind, and this means of knowledge. Vedanta is a means of self-knowledge, proven means of self-knowledge that will, if you're qualified and if you participate properly, it will set you free. Free of what? Free of dependence on objects. And it requires your participation. That doesn't mean you have to talk. You can, as Hilbrin said, you can, the teaching is a setup. We will provoke you with our teaching, and then we will give you the logic that's required to answer that question that the teaching provokes, and you will more than likely, if you're a reasonable person, accept the logic and look at, and this is the hard part, this is not easy. I'm not here to make you feel good, okay? I didn't come here to get you high and to make you feel good. I'm not an entertainer. These teachings are remarkably entertaining, if you have the right frame of mind, but I'm not here to make you feel good. I'm here to get you to think. And the kind of thinking you're going to do this weekend will probably be a little difficult. For this reason, what you believe and what you think may not necessarily be true. And it's, I assume that you're here because you are seekers of truth. You want to know what the truth is, and you want your lives to line up and be in harmony with the truth. And so you're going to hear good news. I'm not afraid to give good news, and you will hear bad news. The good news and the bad news is about equal. And the way you get to the truth is by understanding both the upside and the downside of life. You don't get to the truth by simply pandering to your beliefs and opinions, your views about what you think life is about. So when you hear this teaching, the first stage, the very first stage, Vedanta has three stages of teaching. The very first stage is called listening. And listening requires a lot of discipline. It requires a very professional and mature mind. Normally, when somebody speaks, you have formulated, when they start to formulate an idea or make a statement, you start formulating your reply usually before they even finish talking, isn't it? In your mind, you already have reacted to that, and you feel that you need to respond immediately to what they say. And that kind of listening doesn't work in Vedanta. I mean, you're free to do whatever you want. I mean, it's up to you, obviously. I can't control your mind. But but that kind of thinking doesn't work here. You have to be able to listen carefully without judgment, without complaint, without reaction for 45 minutes. Can you manage 45 minutes or maybe an hour? We'll take a break. It's very hard what we're doing here. It's not easy, mind you, because you have to keep an open mind. You can't just keep your mind, switch your mind on and off. But the reason you can't do that is because this teaching is a complete logical teaching. It's a flow of ideas that starts from A and ends to Z, with Z. And you'll see through these sessions that we're going to have, you'll see the logic. And I will keep reminding you of the logic as we go, step by step by step. So, as you need to hear what's being said, and you need to sign on to the logic as we go. And because when we get to the second teaching, the second teaching depends completely on your understanding of the first teaching. And if you're thinking a whole bunch of thoughts and you're arguing with the teaching in your mind, and I'm going to tell you some things that are going to challenge you, really, for sure. Simply because the vision of Vedanta is non-dual, and the way we're conditioned, the way we've been conditioned, is dual. That is, we think in terms of the subject and object. And Vedanta doesn't think that way. It thinks differently. It understands that the subject and the object are non-separate. Which means that the kind of thinking that we're doing is going to be completely contrary to the normal way that you think. So, it looks like you don't have to do anything. It looks like I'm doing all the work over here, but I'm not. For me, this is easy. I've been doing it for 45 years. So, but for you, it will be difficult because of this conflict that you're going to find in yourself. And we will resolve that conflict. That's why you need a teacher. With Vedanta, you can't read your way to enlightenment. It's not going to work. And just going hopping around from guru to guru and satsang to satsang and taking a little bit of this and that from here and there from these experience-based teachings, it's not going to solve the problem. You need to have a complete teaching, a proven teaching that works. And this works. If you have any doubt, you can read the website, you can read the testimonials, you can talk to some people in this room whose lives have been transformed by these teachings. And so that's your duty. So as Hilbrin said, just hold it for until I, because I want to lay out the whole idea. I don't want you to butt in the middle, because the logic is very, very subtle, it's very, very careful, and if you disturb the train of thought, then somebody else who's, you know, their mind will go off track, and then I have to back up. I will repeat myself as we go, because I need to look at you, I want to see your faces, because I can tell whether or not an idea is going in, because when I give a teaching or an idea, if you scowl and look like this or send me bad energy, then I know you haven't understood. then I can back up and try to formulate it in such a way so that all the doubts are cleared. And we want to go together in this, because it builds up a really nice energy. And you'll notice probably by, you know, tomorrow morning or midday by tomorrow, there'll be a feeling of a group feeling, and everybody will be in the same state of mind, and it'll be very nice to communicate. And then sometimes, you know, it'll be natural. You can pop up a question that's on topic. The problem with the modern teachings is that there's no topic, really. There's no real teaching. There's just talk about awareness or about consciousness. So, you know, people can pipe up and say this and say that, and they don't necessarily have to pay that close attention, because you're not required to think. But Vedanta requires your thinking. Understand? The whole problem that I've got in life is that I'm not thinking clearly. The way I think and the way I am are usually two different things. I'm thinking like this and I am going like that. There's this conflict or split in everybody between their mind and the self. And their self. There's one self, and there's this built-in conflict that everybody has. So we're going to try to get those two things on the same page. We're going to try to get your mind and yourself together. And destroy this sense of separation and smallness and incompleteness and duality that causes our suffering. So that's your duty. My duty is to keep the teaching on top. I can do that. I've been doing it a long time. It's my job. And your job is to listen with an open mind. I'm not saying you shouldn't be critical. I'm not saying you shouldn't argue with it, but you have to hear it. You need to hear what we're saying before you can actually make an intelligent criticism of it. I'd love to hear your arguments. They need to be on topic, and they need to be based, they need to be clearly thought out. Because we've got logic, I tell you, we've got pure knowledge here. This tradition is an amazing tradition. It's like nothing you've probably ever heard of, you know, or seen. And it will challenge you, it will uplift you, it will inspire you. And you probably will get pretty high too. But it's not our job to get you high and make you feel good. There's no power like the power of knowledge. It's the most incredible power in the universe. The whole universe is made out of knowledge. There's not one thing that isn't made out of knowledge. And when you understand who you are and how you fit into the world and how you relate to yourself, your true self, you will be totally happy. Okay, and for this to work, for this teaching to work, we have to establish certain terminology, certain definitions. Because if I say a tree and you're thinking of a cat, that's not going to work. Huh? If I say a light and you're thinking of a dog, that's not going to work. So I'm going to use words in a very conscious way, according to the tradition. None of this, oh, mind you also, none of this is my teaching. Let's get that off the table right now. This is not my teaching. I am a teacher of Vedanta. That's all. And Vedanta is already there. Just like if you go to the university to study science, no scientists say, this is my science. They just tell you what science is. They unfold the meaning of science, whatever it is, biology, chemistry, whatever, mathematics, whatever it is. And Vedanta is just the science of yourself, the science of consciousness. It's completely impersonal. It has nothing to do with me, one way or the other. It so happens that I was taught this science, and it set me free. And as it was worked on me by my teacher, I started to understand how to teach it. And in our tradition, we have a method for teaching. The ideas are not mine, but the method of teaching is not mine either. I'm just a person who operates this great sampradaya, this great methodology. And it works for everybody because there's only one person here. And reality is one. And it's based upon the knowledge that stands behind all the differences. You'll see as we go. So, the first thing we need to get clear, this is first teaching, first basic idea, is what do I want? What do I want? What am I doing here in this life? What am I chasing? What am I pursuing in life? We can't even begin to teach until we're clear what we want. And Vedanta says there are four basic, well, there's more, but we'll just categorize them as four basic pursuits, human pursuits, things that people want. And the first or most basic pursuit that people want, that everybody wants, is security. Once in a while, I'll throw in a Sanskrit term to make sure that you understand. I'm just giving the teaching, but it's not mine. And to refer to the source. That desire is a desire for security. We call it artha. Artha means, I want to be secure. The most obvious form of security for human beings is wealth. If you have enough money, I can't retire quite now because I don't have quite enough money. You know, that it's a big thing now in America that people are having to put off their retirement a little bit. They can't retire until 67 or 68 or 70 because they don't have enough money because of inflation and all of this sort of thing. And they cut the pensions down and interest rates are not. And you know, that desire is a normal and natural desire. Security. Why? Because reality is completely insecure. Nothing stays the same from one minute to the next, does it? If you got your happiness riding on a particular set of circumstances here, and you feel secure when things are set up a certain way, you can bet your life that tomorrow or the next day, they won't be the same way. things are, particularly nowadays in our societies where, and in this, in the world, when there's so many people competing for all of these things that, you know, we want, there's just this tremendous competition, this population of people driving the world. And the objects that we want are in this continual state of flux. They're going here and they're going there, they're coming and going and so forth. So, you know, it's natural to feel that, particularly money, if I have enough money, then at least I can relax a little bit. Or power. Power is a good example. If you can get a power, a good job or something like that, you might feel secure. But, you know, even, well, once you get secure, once you feel that you're secure financially, let's say, what's the next thing you tend to want? Pleasure, luxury, isn't it? Entertainment. Look at these societies. My God, huh? People, they're carrying their entertainment around with them, looking at looking at videos, chatting with people, going on vacations, buying luxury goods, huh? Luxuries have become necessities, in fact, in these cultures. Why is that? Why? Because we got enough security. Don't you? You'd think it when you got enough money, you'd just be happy and sit down, you wouldn't want anything more, wouldn't you? I mean, doesn't that make sense? Yeah, I got enough money, but it isn't like that, is it? As soon as you got enough money, then you got to spend it, you got to go off, you got to satisfy this craving to feel good. Because security doesn't really make you feel a positive feeling. It erases the negative feeling, but it doesn't give you a positive feeling. You need that. You want to feel good. You want to indulge yourself. You want to drink. You want to get high. You want to have sex. You want to travel. You know, you got to do, there's a myth, you know, the whole society is like a huge big playground of activities and objects meant to deliver pleasure. It's probably not lost on you that if you're pursuing pleasure, it probably means you don't feel good as you are. And the third thing that people want is virtue. Virtue means they want to feel good about themselves. They don't want to feel good, they want to feel good about themselves. We've all, as you know, been raised in a Christian culture, Christian cultures, such as Christianity, such as it is. Tells you what? From the moment you're born, you're a sinner. Isn't it? You're not good enough. There's something wrong with you. You need to do this and to do that, you know, to get make yourself okay. And you'll never be okay here. You're going to only be okay when you get to heaven. And the way you get to heaven is, how do you get to heaven? You be a good little boy and girl. You do everything we tell you to do. And then maybe one day in the afterlife, right, you will be happy. You'll be okay. You'll be sitting with the angels on the right hand of the Lord. Da-di-da-da-da-da. Isn't it? And so the parents, they love you when you're really just cute and fat and stupid. Huh? You're real stupid and fat and you're stupid. They just love you. They just can't hug you enough. As soon as you just start to think a little bit and get a little bit, then they start telling you what's wrong with you. Isn't it? Huh? Yeah. You don't feel there's anything wrong with you. When you come here, nobody feels there's anything wrong with them. After 2 or 3 years, you start getting a complex already. What do you want to be when you grow up? As if what you are right now is not good enough. Huh? Isn't it? Yeah. So this built-in sense of inferiority this lack of virtue, that I'm, this feeling that I'm not okay, it's built right into us. And so many people are very acutely sensitive to that feeling, and they try to improve themselves, right, through psychology, through religion, by doing good works. Oh, I've got to go and help the poor in Calcutta. I've got to go with Mother Teresa and pick up the poor. That'll redeem me. Then at least I'm doing something good for the world. I'm such a sinner. Maybe I'll get blah, 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 blah. Recognition, fame, this is another thing we want. We all want to be recognized. Why? Because there's so many of us and we feel so small and inadequate and incomplete. We want people to notice us and recognize us. Look at I saw this guy walking down the street the other day. I couldn't believe his outfit. I mean, the way he was dressed, it was unbelievable. He was wearing his plastic pants and plastic shirt, and he painted it blue and white in all these different kind of patches, and his hair was blue and it stuck out like this. And if you looked past the costume that he had, you saw a really sad person. I felt sorry for him. He was trying to suck some attention, get somebody to pay attention to him, to look at him, because he felt so unnoticed and unloved. Power. Why do I chase power? Why am I, why do I want a clipboard and tell you what to do and what not to do? Because I feel powerless. I feel small. I feel weak. People who chase power, politicians and these people, inside they always have a real needy, weak little person that's constantly trying to be bigger and bigger and bigger and more and more and more powerful. To read about that guy in Ukraine that they got rid of here recently. He was just the most pathetic guy. And they finally opened up his place and they could see. He just wanted to make himself feel powerful. So he robbed millions and millions of dollars and built this great big palace, kind of like a zoo, whatever it was, to make himself feel big. Now, and whatever else, I don't know, maybe there are other things that people pursue, but that's about it. Security, pleasure, virtue, recognition, fame, power, and so forth. If there's any other ones, it's all right. Now, when we analyze this pursuit of objects, okay, here's a word we need to know, okay? I'm going to stop the frame right now, stop the little camera. An object, I use the word an object. What is an object? You need to understand this, because the whole teaching is built upon the object. An object is anything other than you. Okay? Life, if you look at your own experience, now this is Vedanta, is purely experience-based. It's knowledge that's based upon experience. It's not mystical, it's not spiritual, it's not nothing at all. It's just a clear understanding of what is, of reality, based upon observation. That's why we call it a science. If you look at your own experience, and this is true for everybody, you'll see the what? Your life is nothing more than you in connection with, in transition, in transaction with objects, things that are other than you. You, the subject, your conscious, awareful subject, we call it awareness, call you awareness, and you find yourself, right? Presented from every minute of your life, you're presented with objects. And life is what? A transaction between the subject, me, and the objects that are presented to me. by life. That's the, at the most fundamental level, that's what we're doing here. Understand? Now, when I perceive an object, and an object, now an object means what? Do you have any trouble confusing yourself with this chair? The chair you're sitting in? Is anybody, that's an object, right? This is an object. It's something that's known to me. I'm the knower and I see the chair. I'm the experiencer. I experience the chair. It's an object. Now, what about your feelings? Are your feelings objects? Yeah, that's right. Don't look so nervous. Yeah, yes, your feelings are objects. They're known to you. They appear as objects. You know your feelings. Your feelings don't know you, do they? Your feelings have no idea who you are. But it's very easy to confuse yourself with an object, isn't it? If I say something unpleasant, you'll tell your friend, he hurt me. No, I didn't hurt you, I hurt your feelings. No, I didn't even hurt your feelings. What I said hurt your feelings. I didn't hurt your feelings. An object is what you believe in your thoughts. Your thoughts are your identity. James, I'm James. That's an object. James is an object. That's an identity that's known to me. And states of mind are objects. Events are objects. Situations are objects. Anything other than myself is an object. And what life is for me is the pursuit of objects. Either gross objects like physical objects, or subtle objects like feelings or ideas, whatever, beliefs, opinions, and so forth. And when we analyze this pursuit, why do we chase these objects? In other words, what's wrong with the subject that it needs to chase an object? What's wrong with it? Why do you go for these things? Well, because you feel that there's happiness in the objects, right? Is that right? You think the objects you think there's joy in those objects. You think in security, you think there's happiness. In pleasure, you think there's happiness. In virtue, you think there's happiness. In power, you find happiness. In fame, you find happiness. In friendship, you find happiness. Friendship's an object. In religion, you find happiness. Now, why would I try to find happiness in objects? Why would I do that? Well, what's the implied meaning of that situation, of that statement? That I'm searching for happiness in something. Relationships, there's a good one. A relationship is an object. People say, I want a relationship. Now, why would they want a relationship? Why, what's the point? The point is that the relationship is going to give me what? Happiness. It's going to give me joy. It's going to give me whatever, some subjective feeling. It's going to be there. So that's why I'm going for it. Now, when you look at any pursuit, and everybody will be pursuing their own particular thing at one time, but this psychology operates for everybody, irrespective of the object that you're pursuing, whatever it is. When we analyze this situation we find that the joy that you think is in objects is not actually in the object at all. See, I told you bad news. No, this is challenging, isn't it? Because here, what you say is, I'm chasing this and that. Meaning, I want this and I want that. I don't want this and I don't want that. And I'm saying, and Vedanta is saying, hey, there's no point in wanting it or not wanting it because there's nothing there. There's no happiness in it, one way or the other. There's no happiness avoiding it, and there's no happiness gaining it. And what does that do? That like strikes right at the very heart of my whole life, doesn't it? Because my whole life is nothing but chasing objects, chasing stuff, whatever it is. See, yeah, bad news. We're going to prove it to you. We'll show it to you. You have to stick with it, though. Stick with the logic here. You'll see it's not my logic or Vedanta's logic. It's actually the unexamined logic of your own experience. This is something you actually know, but have forgotten. You know, but you don't know. And when we analyze this transaction between a subject and object, which is there, what? Object is meant to what? Complete me, to fulfill me, to give me, to make me okay, whatever it is. We discover that the joy that we seek in objects is not there in the objects. To be fair, it does look like it's there, doesn't it? It does seem to be in the object. Let's take the relationship thing. Everybody's a sucker for love, right? Isn't it? I don't think there's anybody in this room who hasn't wanted a loving relationship with somebody. Right? Yeah. Now, because I feel what? Lonely. But, you know, if I was in love with myself, then it would be fine. I wouldn't be chasing a relationship, would I? Because I'd already be in love with somebody. That would be me. But I'm not in love with me. That, in fact, that's why I'm trying to fall in love with you. That's why I want love from you, because I'm not in love with me. And so here I am, a lonely person. You know, Match.com, and looking, talking, hitting the bars, or wherever you go to find love. Isn't it odd that the people who are trying to find love, try to find love among people who are trying to find love? Isn't that weird? Because if somebody's trying to find love, obviously they don't know what love is. And so how are they going to give you love? But nobody thinks like that, do they? Why? Because we're so fascinated with the objects. We think, if I just get that person, can magnetize, attract that person into my life, then what? Everything's going to be fine. But we believe, that's our belief. And to be fair, you know, you go to the Vedanta satsang and you're looking around, you know. Then you see some cute guy or girl home in the corner and you go. And you smile at them and they smile at you and your eyes meet across a crowded room and the energy comes. Ooh, we can't wait till the break so you can go out and some of these satsangs, I mean, that's all they're doing, basically. They can't wait till the break. They're all checking each other out. And now, here I am, I'm feeling lonely. I see Mr. or Miss, a potential Mr. or Mrs. Right, you know. And they're looking at me, and they got that look on their face that means that they feel the same way about me. And then that feeling comes, and you find yourself together like that, and one thing leads to another, your place or mine, and you end up in love and in bed and in the same house, and so everything's fine. Everything's great. I got my relationship. I got my Mr. or Mrs. Right, whatever it is. And then one morning, just everything's going along very nicely. You're sitting at the breakfast table, reading the paper, and stirring the oatmeal, and your girlfriend... and your girlfriend or your wife says, hey, we don't have any milk for the coffee. And you say, oh, sweetheart, don't worry. I'll just go to the corner store and get some milk. It's no problem. So off he goes. She thinks, oh, what a lovely man. Just like that. I mean, here he is. He's enjoying his paper. It's a nice morning. It's all so cozy here. And he's ready to go out there to the corner store and get some coffee. Let me get some milk for the coffee. What a lovely man. And that's about a 5-minute walk to the corner store. And after 10 minutes, he's not back. And after 15 minutes, he isn't back. And then you start thinking, my God, you know that girl that works at that? She's a serious babe. I'll bet he's run off with her. And what happens when you think that thought? He doesn't come back. Maybe he really did meet the girl at the corner store and thought, she's much hotter than the one I've got home, and I'll take off with this object. So your lover leaves you. And what happens to your state of mind? You're all happy. Huh? You were so happy. Now what happens to your state of mind when your lover leaves you? Everything's cool. I just feel so good. No. Your happiness goes with the object, doesn't it? You're mad, you're angry, you're depressed. You get on the phone, you start, that son of a bitch, you know. Why? Because you think the joy was in the object. And that's why. If you knew very well the joy wasn't in the object, then what? If he went for 10 years, it would be fine. But he's gone 10 minutes and you find yourself, what? Depressed and angry. If the joy was in the object, let's put it this way. Why isn't the joy in the object? Because the same object, if the joy was in the same object would give everybody happiness, wouldn't it? If the objects were full of joy, if that's where it was located, then when I got object X, if it makes me happy, then when you got object X, it should make you happy. But that's not how it is at all, is it? What, an object that makes me happy makes you miserable. You know? Isn't it? But to be fair, now we've got to be fair about this, because we're not trying to blame ourselves for anything. But we're just saying, we're just to be fair, it certainly seems like the joy is in the object. But what is actually happening there? See, this is just an analysis. We're analyzing what? The actual relationship between this transaction between a subject and an object. We're just trying to analyze and see what's really going on there. Not what we want to be going on there. Not what we think is going on there, but what is actually going on there. We want to understand that. Because if we're going to set ourselves free from objects, and we said the purpose of Vedanta is to give you freedom from objects, we need to understand this relationship. To be fair, it looks like the joy is in the object, but it's not. It's, where is it? When, if you look at the transaction, you'll see what? I've got a desire, okay? I'm feeling lonely, and I've got this need, this desire. It's going out, all toward the objects. And then the object appears. Okay? Now the object is here. Then what happens to the desire? What happens to the desire? When the object comes, does the desire remain? No, the desire disappears. Why does the desire disappear? Because it's no longer necessary. It was only necessary to magnetize or to track the object. That's what it's there for. It's to suck the objects that I want to me. But when the object is present, then the desire disappears. When the desire disappears, at that moment, I feel happy. I feel full. I feel complete. I feel high. I feel good. Where is the joy coming from? The joy is coming from myself, when the desire for the object is removed. In other words, my mind, instead of being pushed outward toward that object, keeps clinging on that object, thinking about that object. Since the desire goes away, my mind goes inward and it starts to experience myself, and I experience bliss, freedom, joy, happiness, completeness, whatever you want to call love, whatever you want to call it. What is the conclusion? That the joy that I seek in objects is actually in me. Think about this. What I'm trying to get out of the objects, I already have. See why life is so frustrating? Everything I want, I already have. Because what do I want the object for? I don't care about the object for its own sake, do I? Do you care about the object for its own sake? No, you might, you know, try to make yourself feel good by pretending that you care about the object for its own sake, but you don't. You care for that object, why? Because it makes you feel good. In other words, it's for your own pleasure, for your own satisfaction, that you indulge in objects. Well, if the satisfaction that I seek I've already got, then that's going to what? That's going to derail my pursuit of objects, isn't it? Understand this logic. This is very, very difficult to accept. And you can't move on to the next teaching, our next teaching, until you at least see the possibility that this may be true. Because there's a part of you that's saying, Jesus, what have I been wasting my life for? What have I been, spending all my time with, wasting my life for, if that's true? Because I think the joy is in the object. I think the objects are real. You don't pursue the objects because you think they're not real and not full of pleasure and joy, do you? You actually think that there is something there. Don't blame yourself. Blame mom and pop and the federal government, the TV and everything. Everybody's like that. Everybody thinks like that. All the societies that we find ourselves in tell you there's what? You need to get X to be happy. And Vedanta says just the opposite. Your pursuit of X is making you unhappy. Sorry, I shouldn't laugh. No, I'm only telling you because I went through this myself. I chased the objects like anything. I chased all the most boring conventional objects, basically sex and money and power. I went for those. Oh, and pleasure, no, I did my share of pleasure seeking too. Another sad fact. That's sad fact number one. Sad fact number two. You'll be ready for a break. We'll all go out and have a drink at the bar before the next stop, so you can get your spirits up. No, sad fact number two is what? This field of objects. Remember we said, life is just a neither subject and a whole field of objects that I'm pursuing. This field of objects is a zero-sum game. You know what a zero-sum game is? Okay, a zero-sum game is a game where when you add it all up at the end of the game, the upside and the downside exactly equal. All the good bits and all the bad bits, for every good bit, there's a bad bit. And so the good bits neutralize the bad bits, and you don't get anywhere. Huh? This thing's a setup, man. Haven't you figured that out yet? Huh? Yeah. Yeah, that's why you're here listening to Vedanta. Because you have figured that out. This is a zero-sum game. Go back to your relationship idea, okay? A relationship is lovely. Why? What do I get? I get intimacy. Pillow talk. Like, tell your secrets. And then you tell your secrets and they tell their secrets. And you just feel so intimate. You feel so, That's love. But for that intimacy, what's the cost? What do you pay? That's the upside, big upside. But what's the downside? Attachment. You get attached to that object, isn't it? You say, okay, I've had enough. I hate this attachment. What am I going to do? I'm going to get out of this relationship. Okay, get out of the relationship. Have you won? Did you win? No, you didn't win. Why not? Now you got rid of the attachment. Now you got your freedom. But what? You sacrificed intimacy. Now you don't get your pillow talk anymore, do you? For every gain in this field, for every gain here in life, there's a loss. For every loss, there's a gain. And when you actually look at it carefully and you calculate, just like a business person, the balance sheet. In a business, they have a balance sheet. And in the balance sheet, the assets always equal the liabilities. Otherwise, it's not a balance sheet. I ran a business when I was younger, and I took all my stuff to the accountant, all my figures, and the accountant said, "Hey, that's not a balance sheet." I said, "Yeah, it's a balance sheet. It balances. It doesn't balance because there's less money here than there is liabilities over here. So something's fishy with this. It was fishy because I was cooking the books." And I had to bribe the accountant to make it all look like a balance sheet. Because everything here is like that. Understand. Not a fun thing to contemplate, because I actually think that I can get ahead. I think that I can be a winner here. But for every winner, there's a loser. And the winner that wins is also lost a lot to win. What I want when I want an object is never the object. It's never the object. What I want is freedom from that which the object represents. In other words, when I want security, a good job or some money or whatever, like that, my inheritance, I don't really want my good job or the inheritance. What do I want? I want freedom from insecurity. When I'm chasing pleasure, I want freedom from what? Feeling bad. The object doesn't matter to me. I'm just trying to get rid of this bad feeling. When I search power, what am I trying to do? Trying to get rid of that feeling of being small. Everybody's got that little small person inside, huh? That little small little ego that just wants to be bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, keeps trying to like expand itself, blow itself up. I never want the object for the sake of the object. I want it to remove the suffering that I'm experiencing. And since the objects have neither joy, neither happiness, nor pain in them, the same thing's true for, but when we look at it negatively, desire and fear, pleasure and pain, boil down to just exactly the same thing. One is just a desire is just what? A positive fear, and a fear is just what? A negative desire. Behind every desire there's a fear, behind every fear there's a desire. Behind every pleasure there's a pain, behind every pain there's a pleasure. It's all just one. Life is one. This field of subject and object, this duality, is one. Okay, introduced a term. In other words, and the term, the two words are duality and non-duality. Non-duality, one means non-duality. So I need to explain to you, now we understand what the subject is me and the objects are anything appearing to me. Now we need to understand what duality and non-duality is. Okay? This is very, very, very difficult. You see, sometimes it's very simple. You may probably get it here, but as soon as you get out the door, it'll disappear. You'll see why. Okay. When we say that the reality is non-dual, and that's the fundamental premise from which this whole teaching starts. It starts from the idea that reality is non-dual. Whereas what? I start from the point of view that what reality is a duality, that the subject and the object are separate. That's what duality means. Duality is the belief, and it's just a belief, but I don't know that it's a belief. I think it's actually the way things are. I think it's knowledge, or I think it's the truth. Duality is the belief that the subject, me, and the objects are two different things. Is that true? Well, you know the answer, it's not, but we don't care. You're not here just to parrot this and write it down in your notebook and say, now I know what non-duality is. You need to know why. You need to understand why and how I come to believe that what is one is actually, I come to believe that what seems to be two is actually one. You need to understand why. This is all about the why. I told you, we're getting you to think. It looks like I'm here and you're there, from your point of view. And to me, it looks like what? You're there and I'm here. Doesn't it? I mean, anybody in their right mind that walked in this door would say, yeah, you're there and I'm here. Or I'm here and you're there. Is that true? Here, I'll do this. I don't have anything else, so I'll use my watch. So this is, oh yeah, I got some glasses. Usually I use glasses. Forgot where I put them. I'm in a senior moment. My Alzheimer's is kicking in. Okay. And okay, you clever people who've been around, all right? Keep your mouth shut. Where is this watch located? Where is it located? In my hand. Does anybody disagree with that? Oh boy, you guys are all so suspicious. Okay. It looks like this watch is in my hand, okay? Well, I'll give you that. It's good to be suspicious. No, seriously, you should think about it. But normally, you know, if it weren't in this kind of situation and somebody said, where's the watch? You'd say it's in your hand, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Just off the cuff? Yeah, you'd say that. I say you're wrong. I will prove to you that you're wrong. The watch is not in my hand. The watch is in me. That's my statement. Your view is the watch is in my hand, and my view is the watch is in me. The watch is non-separate from me. Because if it's in my hand, it's not me, it's an object, right? I'm saying that the subject and the object are one, me and the watch are one. And you're saying, no, it's not so. Okay, now how am I going to prove this? Well, I'm going to prove this by analyzing perception. You know, we perceive, everybody perceives, like, you know, perceiving all the time, from the morning, the minute you get up in the morning, till the minute you go to sleep at night, you're perceiving, you're experiencing objects. There's no doubt about that. But what's actually happening when you're perceiving? Have you actually, like, got down into the mechanism and analyzed it carefully and seen what's really going on when you're perceiving an object? You know, like a scientist gets into matter and goes way down to the quantum level and sees what's really, really, really happening down way down at the bottom. Well, we're going to do that with experience. We're going to dig way down to the bottom of our experience and have a look and see what's actually going on when we're perceiving. Now, and I don't think you'll be able to argue with this. Don't argue just to be contrary, but try to follow the logic here. Do you see this watch? You need light. Is that right? You need light. If there's no lights in this room, you don't perceive. So we've established that we need light. Light comes from the lights, and it strikes on this object, the light rays, the little rays. Light. They strike on this object, and this object reflects those rays. They bounce on this, and then they what? They bounce back into the room, and if your eyes are open, well, you've got a little hole in your eye. It's called a pupil. And those little light rays go right through the hole in your eye and they make a picture of the watch upside down on the back of your eyeball. Call that the retina. And then that image of the watch passes down the optic nerve. There's a nerve. It goes down the optic nerve. This is down here at the subtle body, the stimuli. See these little wavy lines here? These wavy lines come from the object. This level here, the air, fire, water, earth, represents material objects. This is a material object. And that the material object gives off stimuli. And those stimuli pass down the optic nerve and appear in your mind, we call it the subtle body. You'll see as we go. They appear in your mind right side up. Somehow during that little journey down the optic nerve, they've been reversed. And when it appears in your mind, you see this watch in your mind. You experience it in your mind. Is anybody experiencing the watch over here? Are you actually experiencing the watch over here? No, you're not. Because if you were experiencing, say the people in the front row are experiencing it, then the people in the back row, they couldn't experience it, could they? Because everybody would be out in front of them experiencing the watch. You couldn't, yeah? But anybody that's got their eyes open can experience this watch. As what? As knowledge and experience. The knowledge, the experience of the watch comes in, and then it is known. It's illumined by awareness, by consciousness. Consciousness illumines that watch thought, that watch experience, and it is known. That's how we know objects. The stimuli comes from the objects, pass through the physical body, the sense organs, and appear in the subtle body as what? As object of experience, their experience here in the subtle body. Now, how far, think about this, how far is the watch from your mind, from your subtle body? Is there like a gap? Is the watch sort of floating on the surface? Your mind is here and then the watch is kind of floating on the surface of the mind a little bit? No? Do you have to, like, get on a little bridge and walk from your mind to the watch? Huh? No. What's actually happening there? The mind, which is formless awareness, the mind has no form of its own. It takes the shape of the watch. In other words, we say in our psychology that the mind is true to the object. Mind is true to the object. Now, if you see my hand here, if I put this here, do you see the watch? No, you see my hand. Where do you see it? You see it in your mind. Is that right? Yeah, same place you saw this, you see this. And that's pretty weird, isn't it? Because, you know, how that works. Because if this appears in the mind, huh, and then it disappears, does it leave a trace in the mind? Like those old computers? Remember the computer screens? You couldn't leave any image on the computer screen because it would etch that image on the screen of the computer, and then after a while you couldn't, you know, it would destroy the screen. But no, it doesn't. The mind takes the form of this particular watch perception, this watch thought experience, and then when I put the hand up, it immediately takes the form of that. It's like magic. It really is like magic. And if there's a dog here, what will happen to my hand? You won't see the hand, you'll see the dog. And this knowledge has nothing to do with you. This knowledge is not object-oriented, not subject-oriented, it's object-oriented. This is how everybody experiences and learns. The mind is like, it's like water or like air. It can just take any shape. And then when a new perception comes in, it just leaves that perception and then it takes the form of the next perception and the next perception and the next perception and so forth and so on. That's why your experience is constantly changing, because the objects around you are in a state of constant flux. And your experience is constantly changing. And there's no separation between the watch and your mind. So actually you're experiencing the watch where? Here, in your mind. In your we call this the experiencing entity. Mind you, this is a science, so I'm taking my time because you have to learn the science and the terminology for this to work. Because as we move on, everything at the later stages is built up on this basic knowledge that we're unfolding here. So The object is non-separate from the mind. That's why they say in yoga and so forth, as the mind, so the world. Whatever is in your mind is what's in the world, and whatever is in the world is in your mind. Assuming that your sense organs are not defective, they're open and operating. So there's no separation between the mind and the object. Now, let's take it one step further. Let's just analyze it one more step. How far are you from your mind? Your mind is apparently an object known to you, like the watch. How far are you from your mind? Is there any, We know there's no gap between the, no separation or duality between the object and the subject, the mind. But how far are you, this conscious awareness that you are, how far are you from your mind? Correct. No distance, is there? No distance. You can't find a line. You think there's a separation between you and your mind. You think there's a separation between the mind and the object. But when you actually investigate, Vedanta's investigation or inquiry, when you inquire or investigate, you can't find a line between the object and the mind and between what? The self, yourself, and the mind. Now, if that's true, one more step. If that's true, then how far are you from the watch? Where's the barrier? Where's the distinction between you and the watch? There's no distinction between you and the watch. Now, what's the fly in the ointment of this street teaching? Because, do you have that saying here in Holland, the fly in the ointment? You have some beautiful, like a cake or something, that fly falls in the icing in the cake. It's, ruins it. What's the fly in the ointment of this treatment? In other words, what is it that seems to contradict this teaching? Or why does it really, really seem to me that this object's in my hand? Because it is in my hand. What? Sir, you just proved to me that the object is in you, in me, and now you're saying it's in my hand. Well, what the hell are you doing here? You're confusing me. What assumption is operating when you see the object in my hands? What are you assuming about yourself? Who do you think you are? Let's put it that way. Who do you think you are when you say that the watch is in my hand? And you would have said this. You thought that the objects were outside forever, from the day you were born. So what assumption are you making that actually puts the object here? The assumption is this: I'm the body. Isn't it? Because if you're the body, then the watch is over here. Fair enough. Can't argue with that. Can't argue with that if you're the body. But, oh my God, this man goes on and on, doesn't he? I want my cup of coffee. We're almost to the end of the first teaching, and I have a break. I assume that this is over here because I assume that what? I'm the body. But is that true? Am I the body? No. Why not? Because, answer, because the body is an object known to me just like the watch is an object known to me, isn't it? Where is the body appearing? Where is the body experienced? In the body? I don't think so. No experience takes place in the body. Why not? Because the body is the same as a chair. The body's inert, insentient matter. The body doesn't have any consciousness at all. It is just inert. It's just food. It's dead food. That's all it is. Meat.
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely. But it certainly looks like it is conscious, doesn't it? Why do you think it looks like it's conscious?
I don't know.
Everybody thinks the body's conscious. We say, no, it's not conscious. It's just made out of food. It's inert. It looks like it's conscious. Why? Because it's non-separate from consciousness. You are you're pervading every ounce of this body. Your consciousness pervades this body from the tip of the toes right up the top of your head and out to the end of your fingers and beyond. Your consciousness pervades everything. And because of the proximity of all objects to consciousness, the non-separation of objects to consciousness, the objects which are inert and insentient seem to be sentient. They seem to be conscious. It's a problem. Om Brahmanandam Brahmasugadam Kevalam Yanamurtim Tvandvatitam Pinganasadrisham Tattvamasya Adilaksham Ekam Nityam Vimalamachalam Sarvadi Sakshi Bhutam Bhavatitam Triguna Rahitam Sadgurum Tam Namami Narayanam Padmabhavam Vashishtam Shaktim Chatatputra Parasarancha Vyasam Sukham Gaudapadam Mahantam Govinda Yogindra Matasya Shishyam Shri Shankaracharya Matasya Padma Padam Chahasamalakancha Shishyam Tam Totikam Bhartika Karamanyan Asma Gurum Shantatamana Toshmi Vishwam Darpanadrishya Maninagari Tulyam Nijantargatam Pasyanatmani Mayaya Bhaivurivod Bhutam Yata Nidraya Yasakshat Kurute Prabodha Samaye Swatmanameva Dvayam Tasmai Shri Guru Murtaye Namaidam Shri Dakshinamurtaye Namaom. So this belief that the subject and the object are two different things is just a belief. It's true as long as you take yourself to be your body, and it's not true when you look at yourself as you really are. We say, you are consciousness. You are awareful, limitless, non-dual, actionless, ordinary, unconcerned awareness. When you have pursued objects for however long, you come to the conclusion that the let's just put it this way, you've had enough of objects. You get fed up. everybody in this room is probably in this room because they have serious doubts about how much happiness or joy there is in objects. The people who aren't in this room are out there chasing objects. It's Friday night. And you know what objects they're chasing on Friday night. That's the beginning of your spiritual life. That's when you start to become mature. Children just want to play and chase the objects all their life. Strangely enough, these societies are just populated by children. Even they got gray hair and running big businesses and bossing people around and all. Basically have the mentality of children, just constantly chasing stuff that they think will make them happy. When you realize that there probably is another solution to this happiness issue, you become spiritual. Maybe you take up meditation, or you read Eckhart Tolle's book, or you hear about the satsangs, or something. You hear that there is this thing called freedom. Alignment's a word. Dalai Lama's a media celebrity. Well, he was. I don't hear much about the Dalai Lama anymore, but at one point, you know, the Dalai Lama's name was synonymous with enlightenment, and everybody was talking enlightenment. Oh, the Buddhists are Dalai Lama's enlightened, and this whole new dimension of reality opens up to you. Spiritual dimension. And you decide to go for or pursue freedom. That enlightenment means freedom. Freedom, as we said, freedom from dependence on objects. You say, I've had enough of being dependent on these things, I'd like to be free of objects. It doesn't mean there won't be objects in your life. Don't mean you won't enjoy the objects. You will enjoy the objects, but what? You won't lean on those objects to make you happy. You will approach the objects as a happy person. You will enjoy and engage yourself with objects happily rather than for happiness. That's freedom. That's all it is. It's non-leaning, non-dependent on objects. Anything obviously other than yourself. And when you come to the spiritual world, you're told that the truth is within or beyond. Both means the same thing. There's different ways of formulating the same thing. It's something other than out there in the world. In other words, you seek within, seek in your heart, look within, turn within. Or transcend, or go beyond your mind and body and go to this higher state of consciousness, to the nirvana state, or to the samadhi state, or you take up yoga, and you're going to now connect this person, this experiencing entity, you're going to connect it. Yoga means to connect, or to communicate. You're going to get in touch with this higher self, this little lower self that you are, this small little inadequate person is going to practice this yoga, and they're going to connect to this bigger higher self, and they're going to merge and become one with their higher self or their inner self or whatever. It sounds, well, reasonable. Maybe. Seems reasonable. But there's one little problem with the whole narrative, the whole spiritual narrative. And that fly in the ointment of this spiritual seeking is that the psychology that you have developed when you were immature and when you were chasing objects, that psychological orientation and that belief in the subject and object has never been examined. And so when you move into the spiritual world, your basic psychological structure moves right along with you. And you don't know that it's come along with you. You don't understand that. It's hidden from you. And so this whole myth of experiential enlightenment is very attractive to you. Enlightenment is presented as an object that I will now obtain. I tried to obtain objects outside, now I'm going to try to obtain that one object where all the happiness is, be either beyond or within, but not out there in the worldly world, in the normal, what I call the normal world. Not that there's anything normal about this world, but... And so you take up some spiritual practice, and everybody, you know, the interesting thing about this world is that wherever there's a need, there's somebody that's going to come out to try to fulfill that need, and fill that need. And so because you have a need to connect with yourself, or transcend yourself, or however you want to formulate the issue, there are dozens of spiritual paths made available to you. In fact, nowadays life is just a supermarket of spiritual paths. Society is a supermarket of identities. The spiritual world is a supermarket of spiritual paths. Everybody's got, I've got just the deal for you, whatever it is. And they're going to give, path means that there's a way to move from where you are as this limited, inadequate, experiencing entity to this unlimited, free being that you really are. You're going to move from here to here. See the narrative, it's a journey metaphor. You see in the spiritual world, the journey metaphor is probably the most powerful metaphor operating in the spiritual world. You're going to get on this path, you're going to walk this path, you're going to do these practices, whatever they are, meditate, breathe, you know, take pilgrimages, surrender to the gurus, blah, 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 you know what it is, the whole nine yards. You've probably all tried a number of different paths. And by faithfully performing these actions, you will what? Eventually get in that higher state or realize that higher truth or merge with your higher self or whatever. It's formulated in various ways, but it all boils down to the same thing. You're going to do this, these practices, to get this result. It's what we mean by we say the psychology, the worldly psychology, just comes right along with you, because how can you get yourself? How are you going to do that? Well, we'll see. But think about it. Now, with actions, you can get what you don't have. You can get rid of something you do have, you can change something, clean something. But can you get what you already got by doing something? No, I was talking with God, and God was like kind of, you know, feeling like God, feeling pretty wonderful. So I said, and he was telling me all the things he could do. He said, you know, I created the sun, the moon, the stars, I made the Big Bang. I'm running the whole show here, and I'm all powerful. And I said, you know, God, you got a big head. You got a small head. Because you think you're all powerful, but I've got something you can't do. He looked at me like, are you kidding? Who is this boy? I could swat him down like, you know. But he was intrigued that somebody would talk to him like that. I said, yeah, take it easy. Don't take it easy. If you can do it, then I apologize for my presumption. You can do what I want you to do. You say you're all powerful, you can do anything. Okay, do this. And he looks at me. What is it? What is it? I said, give me a head on my shoulders. I want a head on my shoulders. Give me that. God, I noticed immediately, like, he starts thinking. Normally, you know, if he's God, he could just give me a head on my shoulders, but he was flummoxed completely. He was like, he said, I can shrink your head to the size of a pea. I can do that. I can blow it up like a balloon. I can make it, you know, huge. I can flatten it like a pancake. I could twist it like a pretzel. But you're right. I can't give you a head on your shoulders. Why not? Because I've already got one. This thing that I'm looking for, this freedom, what does freedom mean? I want to be free of objects. That's what I'm doing here. I'm getting to objects. I think the objects will make me free, but the objects don't make me free. I just get the attachment. So that doesn't mean that the desire for freedom is wrong or bad or can't be fulfilled at all. But this desire for freedom means what? What does that mean? It means I have no limits. There's nothing limiting me. There's nothing inhibiting me, preventing me from being what I am, from being happy. Nothing standing in the way of my satisfaction or my fullness. That's what limitless means. Now, if you analyze this spiritual search, let me ask you this. This person that I think I am, this person, not a good person, not a bad person, just this person. Is that person limited or is it limitless? It's limited. God is limitless. God can create the whole thing, but what about little old me? How limitless am I? Well, I'm not so limitless, am I? I'm pretty damn limited. I was like limited with, you know, some plaque in my arteries. I just had open heart surgery and they gave me 5 new tubes here. I have 5 fresh little tubes that I can clog up with cholesterol. And maybe by the time I'm 85, they give me another, you know, redo me again, cut me open and do me again. How extremely limited we are, huh? You can only do so much. You can only create so much on your own. And your actions, the results of your actions never last, do they? You do an action and you get a result, but it doesn't last forever, does it? It peters out after, you know, a minute or two or a week or whatever it is. It's gone. So now, just look at the logic. This should be a no-brainer. This should not take you any time at all to answer this question. But for some reason, nobody thinks to ask this question in the spiritual world. And this is the question: is it reasonable to assume that a limited being is limited in every way, time-wise limited, space-wise limited, energy-wise limited, knowledge-wise limited, in every possible way. Is it possible for that limited being to produce an unlimited result, a limitless result? That's right. It's not. You cannot. I want freedom, I want limitlessness, and that, but the actions I do, what are the results going to be? They're going to be finite. But I want to be infinite. Understand. See the logic? When you come to the spiritual world, they're telling you, the gurus and all that, all these spiritual people, whoever they are. I don't know, you know, I ran away from that world a long time ago. No, thank you. You know, because there's no logic there. They're not thinking. They're not thinking clearly. They just promise that doer person, that little small person that wants to gain things, they just sell that little person a whole new fantasy, the myth of experiential enlightenment. You can do this and get that. Surrender to me. I'll zap you with a divine energy. Come and get your hug, baby, and I'll transport you. No, we all like fish. Got me, hooked me, you know. They're so hungry. Fish are the hungriest things. They never stop eating. And we're the same. We just never stop craving experience. And we never stop wanting to do things to get things. But this thing that I want, this me that I want, this self that I'm looking for, this consciousness I am, that's already accomplished. So, isn't it? Aren't you already present as an awareful conscious being before you even think of doing one action? Yeah, I guess so. Before you think a thought, never mind all the actions that flow from that thought, but before you think a thought, aren't you already present? And what did you do to get here, by the way? What did you do to get here? And we're not talking your body. Yes, your mom and dad, they did this, and then your body did. But hey, that's not what we're talking about. What did you do to get here? Zilch. Nothing. Nada. Huh? Yeah. Nothing. I did nothing to get here. I was always here. I was always present. One day, what? This little fat baby body appears in front of me. Huh? And the fat baby body morphs into a young child in front of me. And then the young child disappears into a teenager. Am I changing? Do I change? I don't change. The body changes, the mind changes, the experience changes. The one thing morphs or changes into another. The old thing dies off, the new things come on over and over and again. A process over which I have no control. A process is just happening by the will of God or whatever. Who knows what's causing this to happen? But what about me? I'm nothing. I just sit here calmly, peacefully, aware, watching the changes. The same person is sitting here now that was popped out of the womb, right, however long ago. That same being is still present. So you're not going to get that person. You're not going to get that freedom. And that consciousness that is free, it's limitless. It's like the mind. It has no limits. It can take any form without what? Without modifying to the form. That's what freedom means. Limitlessness or freedom means that when something happens, I don't modify, I don't change. Now that's not my experience, is it? My experience is, When something happens, I change. And then the next thing happens, and then I change. I constantly think I'm going through, you know, the call on the phone. What's happening over there? Oh, going through lots of changes. And you don't know that the changes are passing through you, but you're not changing. You think I'm the one that's changing. That experience is modifying me. And limitless means, it's like what I explained to you about the mind here. The mind isn't what? There's no imprint on the mind where an object is perceived. When you see the watch, as soon as the watch is out of your perception, the mind resolves back to clarity. And what? The next perception comes, and the next perception goes, the mind remains pure. It just creates that illusion of an object, and then what? As that object disappears, it just remains the same. That's freedom. That's what limitless means. Limitless means, oh, I'm going to fly to the end of the cosmos. I'll be gone. Limitless doesn't mean big. It doesn't mean big or time-wise or space-wise. I'm going to expand in the yoga text. Expand, I was a yogi, I did these things, and I expanded to the size of the whole universe. They call it Mahima. It's a Siddhi that happens in the yoga world. Oh, that's the one I want. I want to be so big I fill the whole universe all the way up. No, it's not that. That's not what limitless means. Limitless means you just do not change. You're impervious to experience. In fact, this is radical. I mean, seriously radical. This is a big challenge. Freedom, we call it moksha, freedom is what? Freedom from experience. What? What? That's not my experience. My experience is that I'm always involved in some experience. But what we'll do now in the next couple days, we have two days, tomorrow and Sunday, is we'll try to show you, prove to you, what freedom is and what yourself is and how you are actually free of what? Experience and the objects that are appearing in experience. It's fairly clear that you're what? That you're not discrete experiences. But it's not clear that you're not your experience. I'm going to show you that your experience is you, but we're going to show you that you're not your experience. You're free of your experience. Understand? That's what non-duality means. Non-duality doesn't mean that the subject and object are exactly the same. It means they're one. The object is me, but I'm not the object. Just like what? The wave is the ocean, but the ocean's not the wave, is it? The ocean's free of the wave because the ocean exists where there are waves or not, doesn't it? The presence or absence of an object, a wave in my mind, a wave meaning an experience, doesn't in any way negate my existence as what? As awareness. These enlightenment myths, there are many. One of the biggest enlightenment myths is this notion that for me to get here to who I am, I need to kill my mind or kill my ego. You heard that one? That your mind or your thoughts are standing in the way of your self, of your enlightenment. Your ego or your mind, whatever, both the same basic things. The ego is just really just a thought in your mind. Is that true? No. Is there any conflict between your mind, your ego, and yourself? No, there's no conflict, is there? Just like there's no conflict between a wave in the ocean or a gold and a ring. You have a golden ring. Both of them are what? Both of them are gold. My experience and me are what? Awareness are me, but what? What's the difference? The ring depends upon the gold, but the gold doesn't depend upon the ring, because what? I can destroy the ring, melt down the gold, the ring disappears, but the gold remains, doesn't it? It's available to reconstitute in any other form or to remain what? Formless. See, duality, the whole notion of experiential enlightenment, do this and get your enlightenment, is based upon the notion that reality is a duality. Reality is duality. And as we've seen with reference to objects, it's not. It's actually non-dual, but it looks like, what? It's the subject and the object are separate. And this is what we're working on all the time when we're inquiring or investigating. The appearance of life is very different from the reality of life. And we tend to take the appearance of reality as what? As if it were reality. This is why we suffer. Because we're confusing ourselves with the objects that are appearing in us. There's a confusion, an identification, an attachment with the objects that are appearing to us, that life is presenting to us. You may be familiar with Plato's allegory of the cave. In that metaphor, you have a cave with light coming in the back, and these people chained in the cave, and they're looking away from the light at the wall of the cave. And what they see is their own bodies and their own movements and so forth reflected on the wall. They see shadows reflected on the wall, and they take those shadows to be real. And if reality is what? If reality is non-dual, then I don't have an experience problem, do I? As far as like freedom. I don't have an experience problem. Why? Because if reality is non-dual, I'm already free. I'm already experiencing myself as limitlessness. I don't have an experience problem. I've got, what kind of problem do I have? I've got an ignorance problem. See, that's what they don't tell you when you get into the spiritual world. They don't tell you you're ignorant of the nature of reality. They accept your dualistic projection. They accept the ignorance that the subject and object is the same. And they start from there and they try to fix the problem without investigating the basis of the problem itself. All of these experiential teachings are based upon a myth. The reason I'm sitting here talking to you is because I got rather famous by writing this book called How to Attain Enlightenment. And the second chapter tears up all these, is the argument I'm giving you right now. It tears up all these experiential enlightenment stories. And it so happens that there are a lot of people that have gone through the spiritual world, sincere, good people who had tried with all their very best to get enlightened, and after years and years and years and haven't got there. And it's, why is it? Because they actually believe there's something they can do to get what they already got. We're not saying you can't do something, but we're saying you can't do something to get what you already are, to get what you already have. You have no choice about action. You're doing all the time anyway. But the actions you're doing are never going to produce freedom. You can see that by just in your own experience. Whenever you get what you want, then what? The freedom that you get from that object disappears and attachment comes in, and you start needing the object to make yourself feel free. And as soon as you need the object to make yourself feel free, are you free? You're not free. They tell you you can destroy your ego, that's an action. You can stop your mind, that's an action. You can transcend your mind, that's an action. You can do all these things, and that will make you free. Get nirvana, you'll get samadhi. In the Buddhist world, they're going for nirvana. And how do you get to nirvana? Well, you get on the Eightfold Path, and it's a long, hard slog. Instead of like stopping, you know, the Buddha had four noble truths. The first one is that life is suffering. And the second noble truth was what? Desire is the cause of suffering. And then the third noble truth is the Eightfold Path, that is, I need to get rid of the desire, because that'll get rid of the suffering. And to get rid of the desire, I need to do something. That's the Eightfold Path. I need to walk this Eightfold Path, and that gets rid of the desire. And when the desire is gone, then I get nirvana. That the whole thing is what? Subject and object. You're this person, you're walking this path, you're going to do all these things, and then you're going to get your nirvana. And what we say is this. Buddhism's actually just a chip off the tooth of the Vedas. They got all of it from the Vedanta. But they didn't get all of it. Everything they got from Vedanta, but it was only a little bit. They didn't get the whole teaching. Because why not stop at stage two, at the Noble Truth two, and ask, what's the cause of desire? Instead of accepting desire as being real, and then basing all your actions on the reality of desire. Yes, it's true, desire is suffering. We have no argument with that. The very fact that you desire means that you're suffering. Desire means I feel a sense of lack, I'm not happy. So we have no argument against with that particular idea at all. That's absolutely right. Christ on the cross, that's a great one. There's one of the most beautiful, powerful symbols of suffering you'll see. But what's the cause of desire? In other words, why do I want these things?
Ignorance.
Ignorance of my wholeness. Ignorance of my limitlessness. Ignorance of my completeness. Ignorance of my fullness. I don't know that I'm free. I don't know that I'm full. I don't know that I'm complete. I don't know that I am completely not attached to everything. I don't understand. And because of that, what I feel limited and incomplete, and therefore what? I'm a sucker for objects. And this in the spiritual world, what? In the worldly world, I'm just a sucker for worldly objects, but I moved to the spiritual world, now I'm a sucker for the spiritual object. And so I have to repeat this. I'm repeating this because it really got to go in. Because the next talk tomorrow morning is the means of knowledge. Because if I've got an ignorance problem, then I need knowledge. Because the only thing that's going to get rid of ignorance is knowledge. Action will not remove ignorance. In fact, the more I act from ignorance, the more I reinforce my ignorance. So action actually just what? Reinforces the problem. It just keeps the problem spinning and going. So I've got an ignorance problem, and the only solution to ignorance is knowledge. That's it. No other solution. And Vedanta is the path of knowledge. Self-knowledge. Self-knowledge doesn't mean knowledge of Jim or Sally or Pete or something. although that includes that knowledge. It means knowledge of myself as everything that is. Obviously, if there's only one awareness and reality is non-dual, then everything that is awareness, is me, is non-dual. And you can see the amazing utility if you can understand this. Because if you're not separate from me, if in fact you are me, am I going to lie to you and cheat you and injure you and steal from you? Am I going to do that? I'm not, am I? I only steal from or lie or cheat or injure something else. I make sure that all my lying and cheating and stealing goes to the objects. But if the objects are me, if all the people in my lives are actually me and I have that vision of non-duality, then what? How do you treat yourself? You treat yourself with love because your love is for yourself, is beyond the love of everything. You want to solve your problems, your conflicts with life, your conflicts within yourself? Non-duality is the solution, I tell you. You can go to shrink all day long, and all they'll do is fiddle around and check around in the colon of your past for a bunch of shit that hasn't been flushed out. That's about it. All these memories and so forth and so on. And it'll still leave you thinking you're this little person here. We're not against this little person. That's not a bad person or anything of the sort. We're just saying there's a lot more to you than this who you think you are. You have a much greater, grander identity. And that knowledge of that identity can be and is obtained through the vision of non-duality. And Vedanta is a valid means of knowledge for transferring that vision of non-duality to you. So tomorrow at, was it 10:30?
10:30.
Sorry I ran over, but hey, it's Friday night, you got nothing to do. You can hit the bars now. The party's just getting started up here. So at 10:30 we'll meet tomorrow and take up topic number 3, which is the means of knowledge. Namaste, Narayana, Govindam Paramanandam, Keshavam Bhadarayanam, Sutra Bhashya Kritovande, Balavanto Punaha, Ishwaro Guratmeti, Murti Beda Vibhagine, Vyomavadvyapta Dehaya, Dakshinamurtaye Namaha.